Natalia, do you have your phone on? I can hear some music in the background.
No, my phone isn't on.
There we go. That's better. I'm getting feedback for some reason.
Oh, I hear it.
I wonder what that is.
Natalia, do you have your phone on? I can hear some music in the background.
It was me. Meyer. We're so early this morning, Natalia. We got like 2 minutes.
I know. Okay, you know what they say, early bird gets the worm.
Well, we'll just do another round of Mariachi Vargas with Café Colón here on this morning's edition of Cafecito con Colón. We'll get started here in just a moment. We're looking forward to our guest of honor arriving, Anne Romero. Good morning, Dr. Lang. Good morning, Earl Nieto, Don Leopoldo Martinez, and Julie. Thank you for joining us. We got the Martinez clan in the house. And Anne says she's on, so I need to let her in, I suspect. There she says. I love it. Look at Anne, looking so good. Buenos dias. All right, good morning. Good morning, my dear friends, my Cafecito colleagues. My Cafecito crew and every one of you are my extrovert therapists. During this time of the pandemic, you have gotten me through. During times like yesterday and the day before, knowing that I was going to get to spend some time with you was a highlight and a source of strength for me. Thank you very, very much. We are thrilled you're with us on this beautiful Friday. Maybe some snow in our near future here in Albuquerque. We have got a beautiful 9 o'clock this morning here in the land of enchantment, the Tierra del Encanto, the 47th star on the beautiful flag of the United States of America that flies no matter what as a sign and a bastion of hope and freedom and democracy, regardless of individuals' behavior. We are still the most beautiful democracy on the face of the earth. And I am so pleased to have a wonderful guest of honor with us today. This morning, I am going to be able to bring on somebody I have respected, lifted up, encouraged, and believed in, and been inspired by on a very regular basis over the years. She is an incredible, incredible leader in New Mexico. And I was so thrilled when she agreed to come on and be our guest today, as we are co-hosted by the Hispanic Heritage Committee, the New Mexico Hispanic Heritage Committee, and they schedule our guests. I don't have any say-so in that. That's all at the pleasure of the New Mexico Hispanic Heritage Committee and Enlace New Mexico. And they send me the guest of honor typically on Wednesdays or Thursdays, and I get to figure out who is going to be on with me. And I was so thrilled when I got the email that the incredible Anne Romero was going to be our guest of honor today on this edition of the New Mexico Hispanic Heritage Committee and Enlace New Mexico, Cafecito con Colón. Good morning, Anne Romero.
Good morning, Brian. Good morning, everyone. Hi, Natalia.
Good morning.
Good, Hey everyone, this morning, how did they say? My mom's probably watching, so I have to say, Buenos días, la de Dios. So
yes, Buenos días, la de Dios. You got it. And Jonathan Muñiz greets me with that just about every day and makes my day fuller every day when he says, Buenos días, la de Dios. It's awesome to have you with us, Anne. Thank you so much. We will bring you to camera. I know you are a regular guest and observer of Cafecito con Colón, so you know the drill better than most. We're going to welcome our co-host, who does a great job. I've missed her so much. It has been 3 weeks since I've been able to spend any time with my dear friend, the incredible Natalia Garcia, a very impactful mentor with Enlace New Mexico. Good morning, Natalia.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody.
It's great to have you back.
It's great to be back.
How was your New Year's Eve? What'd you do?
Nothing much. We got ready. We did get ready. We got all dressed up and that's it. Stayed home. Just the four of us here.
Stayed home and stayed safe.
Yes.
Well, that's the way that we got to do it here during the time of the pandemic. We got to stay home. We got to stay safe. We had thousands of deaths yesterday, a record day for the number of lives lost to COVID. We had our, I think, second highest day in New Mexico. We were bumping up against 2,000 positive cases yesterday. I think it was 1,800 and change in terms of the number of people who were identified COVID positive here in the Land of Enchantment. And so the spread, our 7-day rolling average is back again with a comma. And it is a very troubling time in New Mexico. But I will tell you that thanks to the leadership in New Mexico, whether it be with our federal delegation or our incredible governor, Michelle Lujan Grisham, and her team, New Mexico has one of the best rates of vaccine deployment in the nation right now. We are doing a phenomenal job here in New Mexico of getting the vaccine, not just delivered to New Mexico, but getting it in the arms of New Mexicans. Remember what I said yesterday, vaccines can't save lives. The only thing that saves lives are vaccinations. We got to get it in our bodies. We got to get it in our arms. So please, I posted up the links yesterday to sign up and pre-register for your vaccination as we are administering these in waves. We've gotten our first responders and our frontline workers taken care of. We're now moving into this week. We've moved into our elders that are in nursing homes and facilities. That has been very smooth, as best I know. And we'll then move to like 1B or whatever kind of categories. I haven't memorized all the different categories, but I know that we're going to be doing 75 and elders, 75 years and older next. But pre-register, it's very, very easy. I put up the links yesterday. I'll try and do that before the end of today's show. I didn't pull that up in advance, but I will do that. And also make sure that you don't spend any of your good hard-earned money during this difficult time to purchase a home test kit. They are free. New Mexico has entered into an agreement to deploy free home test kits. I have mine right here. I'm going to figure out all the logistics today at some point. I'm in, right in the middle. Hey, you know, thanks to Dr. Howie Morales, I am a 2021 Hunt Institute Fellow. The Hunt Institute was set up by Governor Hunt a long, long time ago. Phenomenal, phenomenal organization, bipartisan, governors, lieutenant governors, statewide elected officials, a few big city mayors, some treasurers, et cetera, from around the state. There are about 50 of us that were named as Hunt Fellows this year. And I've been in a very deep dive on that work yesterday and today. And so, but I promise that today I'm going to get to figure out all the logistics. And I think what I'm going to try and figure out how to do to encourage people to do this is to actually do this home test on a live episode of Cafecito con Colón. So that's my goal for, one of my goals for today is to get that done. So I also set up a new computer and all the alerts are going off on it. And I will also figure out how to turn off all those annoying alert tones that you're getting, but you just have to suffer through it today because look, this is live. And you know, you can dock my pay if you don't like this episode because of all the alerts in the background. But 0 to 0 isn't much of a difference, but you are going to be incredibly enriched by our guest of honor today, who's going to come on in just a few minutes. It's 9:07. I'm going to put up some links as I always do. Is that okay, Anne? We doing all right?
Absolutely.
Okay,
I'm having fun just watching you. This is what how I get ready every morning. So I watch Cafecito. So I'm going to have to remind myself that I'm actually on. So I'm ready.
You're so awesome. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's see here. Let's see here. I am, I sent you a quick message in the chat, Anne, there, and we are now on the gallery view. And let me put up some links of the day. Now, look, I, into the early morning hours of this morning, I was glued to my media feeds with just all the incredible and troubling and heartbreaking and infuriating information coming out about what happened. And it seems to me that Anne's timing for being a guest here is so appropriate because she is one of those incredible civil servants who serves with distinction, currently serving with our United States Senator, Venre Luján. But I talked yesterday about us maybe recentering and finding another level of gratitude for those who serve in civil service. Last night, the news was just incredible about some of the particulars about what went on at the Capitol. Most distressing is we lost a civil servant in law enforcement with my tocayo, Brian, falling from injuries suffered during the mob event. And pretty instantly, and I was very glad to see this, federal prosecutors and the U.S. Attorney's Office have already said that they plan to open up a federal murder investigation into the death of Officer Sicknick, Brian Sicknick, of the U.S. Capitol Police. Let me give you the CNN link to that story. Good morning, everybody. I'm sorry I haven't been watching the chat this morning here. Thank you, Dr. Lang, for validating, making sure that we do our home tests and making sure that we get our vaccinations. Good morning, Jonathan. Change is happening. You're right. We got about 11 and a half days to go. And thanks everybody for these notes. Thank you, Dr. Jennifer Gomez Chavez. Thank you, Chris Katechis. You know, let me just say this. In my third year of service as your state auditor, my team has enjoyed some great success, but somebody who helped me get that office set up and help stand it up was Chris Katechis. And I just want to say thanks, Chris, for your work in my office at the Office of the State Auditor. And I wish you continued success in your current role. You're crushing it. I know that you are enriched and we are better for your continued work. Good morning, Lynn Troyon, and I appreciate you very much. And good morning to each and every one of you. Thank you, Dr. Lawrence Roybal. And thank you, Flor Balderas, who contacted me very early this morning, concerned that I still intended to go out to DC with Rafael for the inauguration. And in fact, a few weeks ago, we made the determination that it was not safe to travel and that we would not go to the inauguration. Although that was heartbreaking because Rafael went to the last three inaugurations, President Obama I, President Obama II, and then also went to the inauguration of President Trump and the counter inauguration for President Trump. So he's been to lots of inauguration events, and I was going to really enjoy being with him in our nation's capital for this inauguration, but that is not in the cards. So my links are not organized well this morning, but I am going to throw several of them up. You know, Elon Musk bumped Albuquerque native for being the richest person in the world. After being about 1 month from bankruptcy, he tells the story, and is now Elon Musk is the richest person in the world, eclipsing Jeff Bezos, Albuquerque native. There's the Bloomberg story on that. These links, forgive me, these links are just a mess today, but let me give you a couple of KOB 4 stories. This is the one reflecting on and reporting out. Good morning. Good to see you, Ms. Bustios. Wow. I hope you and Scott are doing wonderfully well. Scott, a leader in the solar sector, and my dear Jewish sister, great to see you this morning. Thank you for joining me. And there is the story a little bit more texture on Brian Sicknick's passing and death. And the stories are just horrific. I mean, there's a story that one of the rioters actually used a fire extinguisher and hit this officer so bad that actually took his life. Stories about Molotov cocktails that were thankfully not thrown in the Capitol. Stories of weapons, and it's just unbelievable. But while that's so unbelievable, and for those of you that know my work, know that I have been doing everything I can to hold Commissioner Coy accountable for his actions as it relates to financial transactions in the county that he represents. He now is on record of celebrating and amplifying the message of the rioters this week. And there's the KOB story on that. In terms of my other favorite station that always brings me the good news, thank you, KRQE, for all you do to lift up New Mexico. Here's a beautiful story about some good stuff going on there about APS seniors being honored for finding ways of helping others. And I covered that that story earlier before KRQE got on it a few weeks back. So thanks for covering them getting honored for their good work. Here's a great story about the COVID rollout going more quickly in rural New Mexico, which is awesome because rural New Mexico often, and Anne knows this, often gets the short end of the stick when it comes to resources in New Mexico, and often doesn't have as well amplified voice when it comes to meeting their needs. But this shows otherwise in terms of the COVID rollout. So we're very excited about that. And one of my favorite hospital administrators in the entire state of New Mexico, all 33 counties, Christina Campos, is really a phenomenal leader. And I know that she doesn't watch Cafecito con Colón, but if anybody of you know Christina, make sure she knows that I'm a huge fan. I think I've already told her, but you could accentuate that message for me if you know Christina. She is truly amazing. She had a very distinguished career. She's now serving there at the Guadalupe County Hospital, and she could be printing money in the private sector, and she continues to be one of those civil servants that we need to appreciate, celebrate, and lift up. So there's a great story there. The other thing I wanted to cover in the Albuquerque Journal today, Virgin Galactic continues to work hard being the anchor tenant there at Spaceport America. Good morning, Steffi Mack. Hey, thanks for reaching out to Mo Fitt. I know that you and he have been in a dialogue. I will tell you, I've spent already two sessions with Morris White. You saw him here on our New Year's Eve spectacular Cafecito con Colón. And he is doing some things to help me get my posture corrected and do some things to help me be more aware of that, because I walk like Cro-Magnon, man, and my knuckles drag on the ground. And it has been to my wife's dismay, my mother's dismay, my grandmother's dismay. And I'm finally trying to correct it after 50 years. So anyway, let's see my links. Okay, it's 9:15. I got to get to Annie. Here we go. Look, Common Cause, bipartisan organization, phenomenal public policy group who's done just great work in the public policy sector. Kind of shocked me, but maybe I shouldn't have been shocked. But they did come out yesterday and call for Congresswoman Harrell's resignation after she voted to overturn the results of the 2020 presidential election. I thought that was very interesting. I think you might find it interesting as well. And let's see, what else do I have here for you? This is a good one. And then I'll get to our guest today. So New Mexico launched its call center to boost vaccination efforts. So check out this good story in the Albuquerque Journal today. Thank you, Alex. Yes, Alex, I'm going to be on your show. I don't know that we locked down a date for that, but Alex is a real leader in lots of public policy education. She's got a great platform, and I am looking forward to doing your podcast. So yes, Alex, thank you for posting that. Folks, check that out. I closed the link. There's this great multi-gajillionaire woman who is, I think she's out of Scotland. Man, I'm not going to be able to find that story, but it gave me a good chance. So here's her. Look, Natalia's laughing at me because she's like, you already said it was 9:15 and you're supposed to get to the show. And here I am still going. Sorry. But I wanted to lift up women to be, because I thought of Christine Glidden this morning, my fellow honorary commander at the base. She founded Women to Be, an incredibly impactful organization to give women around the world, and specifically young girls around the world, an opportunity to have dignity during their menstrual cycle, and to really educate girls around the world about the importance of being able to understand kind of some of the things that they're going through during those times, and also to provide reusable hygiene products, women's hygiene products. And so I can't find the story right now, but this woman in Scotland called it the period poverty, because young girls and young women are ostracized from communities during their cycle. And this obviously impacts their capacity for earning and things like that. And she is taking a deep dive into education on that. And I think Christine Glidden needs to learn about the work she's doing, because they ought to be collaborating. Here, okay, my last one, I promise. Here we go. My last link of the day is going to be this. Folks that are regulars on Cafecito con Colón, those of you that are my extrovert therapists know that I'm a Robert Glaser fan, Bob Glaser, and his Friday Forward. He did a great article about not just setting New Year's resolutions, but changing our habits and really setting out for a powerful 2021. And I hope you'll enjoy that story as well. Good morning, Juliet. Good to see you this morning. And that is all I've got for our links of the day. And what I'm going to do now is I am going to, let's see, Anne, is there any way you can turn that phone to landscape? Because you are so amazing. I'd like to see the most of you if I can. But if it doesn't work out, that's okay. Mm-hmm. Because while you're trying to do that, I'm going to let Natalia kind of read into your bio. She's going to select a few of the highlights there. Out of your very long bio, we did some Googling and I got a ton of information. Natalia got some of it, but I'm going to ask her to pare some of that down, because I've already stepped on the show by 4 minutes. So we got to go short with the bio, but it is incredible. Let me just say this. I think I started the show saying how much of an inspiration Anne has been to me. She's been a source of joy. When I see her, I can't help but smile, because she's got that million-dollar smile backed up by a soul that emits positive energy. And whether it's when she was a leader in the healthcare sector, when she was a leader in public policy, and now as she helps lead United States Senator Ben Ray Lujan's office, she has got just one of the best dispositions I've ever met in a human being. And I am so proud of her. And former Miss New Mexico, I think, and she was into pageantry. And then public policy. So she's all about the P's, pageantry and public policy. And she is making a difference. You like that, Anne? I just came up with that on the fly.
I love it. I need that on a t-shirt.
Right? Pageantry and public policy equal huge impact. And that's what Anne Romero is all about, huge impact. So with that, I'm going to just say love you very much, Anne. Thank you for being a New Mexico civil servant who makes a difference every day. And I'm going to turn it over to Natalia Garcia of Enlace, New Mexico, my wonderful co-hostess, who I'm so glad to see after missing her for 3 weeks.
Yay. Okay. Let's see if I can do this again. I'm a little rusty. Anne Romero was born here in northern New Mexico, in Española.
¡Viva Condado de Río Riva!
She graduated from New Mexico Highlands University with a bachelor's in political science and a master's in public affairs. Anne has a Anne's background is in policy with a specialized focus on behavioral health policy. Anne started one of the state's first suicide prevention programs, Yellow Ribbon, which focused on implementing and providing suicide prevention training in New Mexico schools grades K through 12. In 2005, she drafted the SJM 61 and worked alongside youth in her community of Las Vegas to pass one of the state's first pieces of legislation related to suicide prevention. She and worked in the New Mexico Department of Education to include behavioral health into grades K through 12 benchmarks. As the state auditor mentioned, she is working with the state capitol right now. I lost my place.
What she's doing right now is it's amazing. She is actually the state director. Talk about a big job and some incredible capacity to do that job that Anne has. She is the state director for newly elected, newly sworn in, but always impactful and incredible former congressman from the 3rd Congressional District, our United States Senator, Benray Lujan. That's what she's doing right now.
Yes, and that's amazing and awesome. And I'm sure she would like to elaborate more on that.
I'm sure she would. That was a great job, Natalia, on the fly. You did a good job. Thank you very much. I'm so glad you're back with us. Thanks for being an impactful mentor with Enlace New Mexico, serving with Dr. Lawrence Roybal, who is absolutely a regular and a very cherished extrovert therapist that I use on a daily basis. So with that, we're going to turn it over to Anne Romero. Anne, I could take this interview in a million different directions, but what I'd love for you to do is start with telling us what fuels your passion. What are your passion points? And let's talk a little bit about, as we enter this new year, I thought we could talk about the events of this week at the Capitol, but really, I just want to lift up New Mexico today. And I think we're all kind of overloaded with the news. I've had on my screen back here, I've had my 24-hour news cycle. I'm exhausted from scrolling last night. And my heart is hurting, and I need some Anne Romero therapy. So tell us about your passion points, because you, when you talk about your passion points and you talk about your journey, we just can't help but be in a great mood on this beautiful Friday, the 8th day of January.
Well, thank you, Brian. And again, thank you so much for inviting me to be on Cafecito. Thank you, Natalia, for that introduction. I really appreciate it and all the work that you do with Enlace. And thanks to everyone that's tuned in this morning. You know, Brian, I just have to say that when the pandemic started, I think folks were scared and stuck at home and trying to figure out this new life. And you've provided a great positive outlet, because I think it's important that we always look forward. We always look towards the light, look towards the leaders. And that's really kind of the focus that I've taken. And when you talk about what's one of the things that fuels my passion, I think I'll add another P into the pageants and politics is people. I love people and I love New Mexico. So I think that that's always been the best way. I was raised by teachers, my mother, my father, my grandfather was a teacher. And so growing up, it was always instilled in us and service and how can you help people? How can you help others? And so I think that's really kind of been the foundation, is that I love people, whether it was through music, whether it was through politics or policy, always looking at the ways that we can help one another. And I can say that it helps me. And I know no one more than you understands that, Brian, and that you're always looking for the ways. There's as you said, with the news cycles and everything that's happening in our world today, it's really easy to kind of fall into those moments where we kind of get stuck, if you may. But I think even it happens to myself, and I try to really be mindful of the time that I kind of put into some of that. And once I start to kind of feel like, okay, feeling a little bit down, I'm gonna tune into Cafecito. I'm gonna go hang out with my dogs. You know, I'm gonna check in with a friend. But I would say people is really what fuels my passion, helping others.
It's the people-powered Anne Romero, pageantry, public policy, or politics, as she says, and people. But people being the most important thing that drives Anne Romero. She leads from her heart. She is an incredibly high-capacity leader, and she's been that way, whether it's behavioral health, suicide prevention, all these areas where she has taken a deep dive in her very few years on this planet, she has had a disproportionate level of impact because she has had a lifetime worth of impact. And Dr. Jennifer Gomez-Chavez has given you props and so many beautiful comments here on this incredible Friday morning with Anne Romero and Natalia Garcia. Anne, can you tell us a little bit? Let's take it back to the roots. You know, we hear, I do everything I can to lift up, you know, Rio Riba County, Condado de Rio Riba is one of my favorite in New Mexico. And, you know, I love all 33 counties. Some I love a little more than others on particular days. And I find myself loving on Rio Riba County more than others on a lot of days. And partly is because I feel like the narrative associated with Española, with Rio Riba, is not an accurate narrative. And so I love being able to lift up people like you who have been born in Rio Riba County, who, when you left the hospital, you left in a lowrider with your family, and the beautiful culture that is so prominent in Rio Riba County. Can you talk to us a little bit about growing up and being a beautiful story of success? And let's highlight some of that upbringing that you had that allowed you to flourish as a beautiful leader and a wonderful woman who inspires many, many young women along the way.
Thank you. Yes, so I was born in Española. My mom is from Dixon. My dad is from Las Vegas. So I was born in Española. And I was driven home in a lowrider, true story, by my uncle Levi Romero, who's our New Mexico poet laureate, actually. So he always says, if anyone questions how New Mexican you are, you have the proof. I have the photo. And then I was raised in Las Vegas. My dad is from Las Vegas, so I was raised there. And growing up, you know, had a big family. And I think the one thing, you know, sometimes when folks ask me this, I always go back to the fact that in our house, the one word we were never allowed to say was can't. I can't do something. It was actually forbidden. And so there were never any boundaries. Everything was just very limitless. My parents were wonderful in that if you know, my brother said he wanted to be an artist, my parents went out and got a full art kit. You know, I said I wanted to be a singer. My parents went out and got me a karaoke kit. My sister wanted to be a veterinarian. Our entire house was filled with animals. So they really kind of just planted that seed that anything was possible. And I never felt like, and growing up, I know that my parents were teachers. So there were rough moments growing up where, you know, sometimes they couldn't pay the light bill. Sometimes we struggled. And I remember looking at those moments, but never feeling like we were going without, because we were raised with a lot of love. And my dad was just so positive that, you know, I think through those struggles, it really embedded in me that, you know, when things get hard, that's when you have to fire it up. You have to get creative, you know? And so I really look at those moments. In that time, it wasn't fun. And I know that a lot of young people, a lot of folks in our communities can relate with that. I sometimes share this story of when I was in elementary school, my dad had this old beat up blazer that he would drive us to school in. And it, like, you could hear it 10 miles up the road. And it was extremely embarrassing to be to be seen in that with your friends, your kid. And I remember my brother and I, we saw other kids from school. And so we were in the back seat and we ducked down. We didn't want anyone to see us. We were so embarrassed. And my dad stopped the blazer, you know, in all of its loud glory, rolled down the window. It's like, you know, it was like the old school roll down the window. And then he told all of the kids that we were in the back seat hiding.
I love that.
And I remember I just like wanted to like melt, you know. But it was a good lesson for me that you have to be proud of who you are, where you come from, no matter. It's your story. That is what makes you who you are. And it was a great lesson, one that I embraced fully. And so I tell folks that, you know, as a kid growing up eating beans and potatoes and tortillas, When I worked on Capitol Hill, I'll tell you that what I would have given to have beans and tortillas, right, on the hill. And I used to bring it actually sometimes. But who you are, how you're
raised, all you had to do was go visit Patsy.
I know, actually, Patsy. Yes, very true.
Right.
And so, yeah, so it's part of your story. Be proud of that. And being from New Mexico, there's no other place I would rather be from. Our culture, the food, who we are as a people, our history is just so embedded in part. It runs in our veins. And so I think that, you know, getting started has really kind of created my path on public service.
I love that. And it's been a beautiful path of public service. And whether it was on the Capitol or on New Mexico soil, you've always made a difference. And I'm just grateful for you. And thank you for coming back home to be able to serve our United States Senator, Benry Lujan. As we talk on this New Mexico Hispanic Heritage Committee Friday, we definitely want to amplify your message of being proud of your story, because we always say, viva la herencia, viva la cultura, viva la gente de Nuevo México. And, you know, the way that we can really lift up New Mexico is to tell our story, and not just tell it, but be proud of it, con orgullo. And, you know, it's just a beautiful thing to see somebody like you who's got roots in Rio Riba County. You've got roots in San Miguel County. You've got a beautiful, beautiful family story. And I always appreciate when you tell it. So thank you for sharing that with us. Tell us a little bit about what it's like now to be the state director. Look, this is a big deal. Like, folks, if you're not engaged in the political landscape or the civil service landscape, it's easy to underestimate what that means. To be the state director for a United States senator is not to be taken lightly. It is an opportunity and job that is one that has a substantial amount of gravity. And to be able to have a relationship with somebody like that, and to be able to see a strong woman with a powerful voice who is from New Mexico be able to lead the United States senator's office in New Mexico is something that really should be applauded. And I just want to congratulate you on that opportunity. You've earned it, you deserve it, and you'll serve with distinction. And tell us what that looks like for you now on a daily basis, particularly maybe even during these difficult times. But again, we want to lift up New Mexico today and be a source of light. So I know there's a lot of positive things you can talk about, because I know you work for somebody who I've been friends with for a couple decades now and watched him grow long before he was elected. He and I were trying to figure out what it was like to be an individual who cares deeply about our state and how we find the path to be able to give back and to live that life of service and gratitude that he had modeled for him by his beautiful father, the speaker, Ben Lujan. So maybe speak to that a little bit, Ane, and then we'll turn it over to Natalia, because I know she's got lots of questions. She already texted me and said, quit talking, let me ask my questions.
Yeah, well, I think I'll just start this off by saying my grandmother had a saying, which I think all New Mexico grandmas probably said this, but dime con quien andas y te diré quien eres. You know, and for those of you that you know, tell me who you walk with and I'll tell you who you are. And I can just say that it's a true distinct honor to work for Senator Lujan and to be part of his team, his family, as he calls us. But he has always been a public servant. A lot of folks don't know. I actually served in student government with him at Highlands University. And he was upperclassman. I had just come in as a freshman, but he actually helped me write my first bill ever, which was to put speed bumps around campus at Highlands. And then through the speaker and always just sharing his knowledge. You know, I think that when everything was happening in the Capitol, there was a report that had just come out of a Hill reporter who was walking the halls and wasn't going to be allowed to pass through. And the senator said, he's with me. And that actually came out in the paper. You know, I think it was a true representation of who he is, because it's very true that leadership is more about what happens when nobody is looking. And I can tell you that when we saw that, it was just very clear of who we know who he is as a person and who he is as a leader. And he challenges us every single day to how can we help more people? And I think in his role in the Senate, that was continuously what the message was, is now we can help more people. And it's 24/7 for him. And I can tell you that it wasn't until you kind of talked about the role that now I'm a little bit nervous. I didn't, you know, it's just that the work continues. The work is always there. And I'll say that, you know, when everything happened, you know, what are we now, the day before yesterday, our team, you know, it was a trying day, scary day, but I think the senator's statement that he put out was, I'm ready to get back to work. Is that you always have to be moving forward, no matter what it is. There's always going to be difficult times in life, in professional and personal. And you have to take those moments, take what you can and learn from them. How can we improve it? And I think what we've seen come is that it's something that the senator has talked about, is that we have to, how do we get people to work together? And those are the marching orders that we've been given, is how do we go to every part of New Mexico and talk to every single New Mexican? Because a lot of people right now are in a lot of need of help, and we are getting our offices up and ready, but we're here to serve. And I can tell you that there's no greater job in the world. I truly say this. I know sometimes it sounds cliche, but when I came home from working on Capitol Hill, I came home because I felt like my time, I learned everything that I needed to learn in DC. And I felt like it was ready to come home, be closer to family, be closer to all the people that I love. And I get the best of both worlds. I really feel like I get to be here at home and I still get to do the good work, and I get to work for an amazing leader. And so really looking forward to the years ahead.
Well, we are too, and we will continue to support your growth. You know, you've got huge fans out here like Patricia El Chavez, who we've all watched you over the last several years kind of grow into this powerhouse of a New Mexico leader. So thank you for sharing yourself and for serving our state with distinction. And Nancy Cooper, good to see you this morning. And yes, keep moving forward on it. Thank you for underscoring that. And Dr. Jennifer Gomez Chavez for highlighting that in the chat. And check out Robert Glazer's Friday Forward link that I posted earlier today. So with that, let me give Natalia Garcia, another dynamic woman leader here in New Mexico, and let her interact with you a little bit, because I could easily hog all the time here, but I'm going to try and step back and let Natalia take it away.
Thank you. When I was reading your bio, the thing that caught my eye was how you started the policy for suicide prevention programs and training here in New Mexico. And my question is just why. It's a great program and we do really need it. Just what got you interested in that?
No, thank you for that question, Natalia. So when I was 13, I lost a very close friend to suicide. She was 15. Someone who was just dynamic, a beautiful human being. My first friend, I always tell folks. And it was the first time I had ever even heard the word suicide, being 13. My nephew is 13 right now. And it truly impacted me in that I kind of just, I knew she was so amazing and would have gone on to do so many amazing things, that I wanted to, and I didn't know how, you know, at that time when I was 13, I didn't know how, but I made a promise to myself then. That's really led up to all of the things that I've done, is that I said, I'm going to live and lead my life doing all of the things that I know she would have done and accomplished. And that was really kind of the roadmap for me, especially when I was competing for the title of Miss New Mexico to go to Miss America. And so that's what really laid the foundation for my work in suicide prevention, because everyone has struggles. But the thing that, the message that we share with folks is that suicide is permanent, it's forever.
And if you or someone you know is struggling, it's critically important to know that you are not alone and that it's okay to ask for help. I think our society has really taught us, sent a message, a wrong message, that if you're not perfect, if you don't get straight A's, if you're not, you know, if you don't have so many likes on your TikTok or social media, there's a lot of pressures. And that's not the reality, right? Is that every single person has value. You have something to give. We're all here for a purpose, and that's to connect with one another. And so many times I find young people through this work who have, you know, they're so different. I was different growing up. I was very different growing up. I looked different. You know, my background was different. And so I struggled with that for a very long time. And when we lost my friend, I didn't know how, but I said, I'm gonna do all the things I can do to keep her memory alive. And starting Yellow Ribbon really was born from that. And I've had family members who have struggled with mental health issues. But I'll just tell you this, is that the one thing I learned is that talking about suicide will not cause somebody to think about it or to follow through with it. And I think many people are so afraid to even say the word. Talking about it makes it less likely to happen. And when I look at our suicide rates for New Mexico at that time in 2000, when we were number one in the country. And so starting Yellow Ribbon was, I started out with my mother and a youth group in Las Vegas, New Mexico. We did a lot of great work, and we started the, you know, we even worked with the Navajo Nation. It's still work that I do today. And so thank you for that question. But Brian, I'll share, if you have the crisis hotline number, it would be a good resource to share with folks. And just know every single person, at times we're gonna need to ask for help. So make sure that you're identifying, you know, and I'll end with this, that you identify at least three people, one person in your home that you can go to in time of need, one person maybe at work or at school, and then one person in the community. And I challenge you all to write those names down and those phone numbers, keep them close by somewhere. Because when we find ourselves in a difficult moment, we sometimes feel alone. And so it's just a good way for us to look at this and say, okay, these are my three people I can go to in time of crisis. But having the National Crisis Hotline number, which is 1-800-273-TALK. So 1-800-273-TALK is the National Crisis Hotline number. And I'm sure Brian will put that link up there. So suicide prevention is something that I'm gonna do for all of my life until we ensure that everyone knows that it's okay to ask for help.
That is a perfect message. Thank you, Anna, for that. We've talked a little bit about that on Cafecito over the last 10 months, and thank you for spotlighting that work. And great question, Natalia. As always, we wanna say thanks to Carolyn Garcia Mack for joining us this morning, and Marianne, and the incredible other civil servant that you know, Anne Martinez de Baca, is with us this morning. Thank you for your leadership with Dr. Howie Morales, and also there was one other person I wanted to give a shout out who joined us, not just Nancy Cooper. We're glad Nancy's with us, but there was one other person who's blowing you up here on the chat. And I wanted to, Rachel, nice to see you. I'm not gonna be able to find it. Lala, good to see you this morning. PLC, I already gave you your shout out. Gabby, glad you're here. Catherine and everybody. Let me just let Natalia ask another question, but let me just also reiterate that it was a powerful message. I typed it in the chat. Suicide is permanent. I'm not sure I've done enough work in that sector to really hear that before. But to me, that hits me very strongly. And you have the National Suicide Hotline in there. You have the Agora Crisis Center in there. You've got the New Mexico Crisis Line, which is, if you feel like you may not be having suicidal ideations, if it may not be that dark for you, because when you get to that point, you're in a very dark place. And so Anne's advice to identify those people who are your support system that you can call in advance is really an important technique. Because if you get to that dark place and you haven't already done that, it's going to be hard for you to actually find the light to even identify who to call. And so I appreciate Anna giving that technique in advance. And I also put the crisis line for New Mexico in the chat. And I also put my personal cell number in the chat. As is often the case, I'm always honored and humbled when people call me in their dark moments, because I know that that's a signal of trust and an opportunity for me to be supportive. And you can always count on me having more time. And like you know, my Cafecito colleagues know that I'm never busy. My schedule may be robust and enriched, but I'm never busy. So don't ever hesitate to call me. So with that, we'll turn it back over to Natalia for her next question.
Okay, my next question is a little bit more upbeat. I just want your advice on women, especially women of color, pursuing a career in political science. Do you have any advice for them?
Mm-hmm. So I think my best advice is to just, you know, the Nike slogan, just do it. I'll just say that I had the distinct honor of working for Congresswoman Grace Napolitano, who is from a congresswoman from California. She's the leading member both in House and Senate and Capitol Hill for all behavioral health policy legislation. And she's originally from Brownsville, Texas. And the congresswoman, her maiden name is Flores. But, you know, she told me one day that no one is going to hand you anything because you're Hispanic and because you're a woman. She said, it's never gonna happen. I'm telling you right now. She said, in fact, you're always gonna have to work 10 times harder. You're gonna have to always be more ready than the person next to you. And she just shared her personal experiences of how throughout her career, sometimes she was the only female, sometimes she was the only Hispanic person in the room, sometimes the only person of color in the entire room. And she said, but you belong at those tables. You belong in that room. And so, yes, have I found, sometimes I've looked around and I'm like, oh, yes, I have found myself, but I never go into that room thinking that. Like, I never go, am I the only female? Am I the only person of color? Because I go into those rooms and I say, I belong here. I belong at this table. Always knowing that you're carrying your community with you. And it's a big thing to carry, you know, when you're carrying your community, communities that maybe have never even stepped forth in some of those rooms that you will find yourself in. But we have a responsibility to walk through those doors and keep them open. And I think that Congresswoman Deb Haaland, who's set to be our next Interior Secretary, she is a great example of that, in that as she continues to walk through those doors, not only does she keep it open, but she pulls you along with her. And so we look to women of color, strong women of color. I think I find a lot of that with my mother. When I was running in student government, I said, you know, I had my whole campaign plan out for student government at Highlands University. I was going to run for secretary. My mom said, well, why aren't you going to run for student body president? And I said, oh, I guess I never thought about that. So I said, okay, well, we're going to change this campaign. And I ran and I won. And at that time, I didn't realize it, but I became the first elected a female student body president at the university. I won by like 11 votes, but a win is a win. And so what I will just say to you, Natalia, is to just do it. Is that sometimes it doesn't matter. It will be a harder road sometimes, but just know, I actually had a great, you know, when I was working for the congresswoman, I sat at this table way in the back at an event, and I ended up sitting next to Ricardo. His brother, Cesar Chavez's brother. And he told me that how they knew things that they were about to make a big difference was when things got harder. So he said that that was always the thing that kept them going. Is he said, you know that you're on the bridge of success or reaching your goal, the harder things are getting. And so whether it's the color of your skin, your gender, you just bust through those doors and you don't take no for an answer. When people close the door on you, you look for the window, you know, you get at that shovel, you do whatever it is you need to do that's in your heart. And when you follow that, you'll never go wrong. And so you may stop and you'll look around and you see yourself as the only female or as the only person of color in that room. Always know that you belong there. And I'll just end with this, is that when I was working on the Hill, Congresswoman Napolitano was asked to work on some legislation with President Obama and our now incoming President Joe Biden. And I'll never forget that she said, "You're going to come to the White House with me and be my staffer." I was like, okay. You know, and I walked in and I'll just, you know, everyone was there in their nice suits. And I was very proud. I had like, my dress was from like Marshalls and I had these favorite shoes that I had. They were, this one staffer said, "Where'd you get your shoes?" And I said, "Ross."
There's a whole hierarchy of those stores. I was just talking to one of my mentees about that this week, and the whole hierarchy of those stores. And I wish I could remember the other two. It was like, was it Gordon's or what's that other one? Or starts with a G. But there's a whole hierarchy of those stores, huh? Right? Like when I was growing up, the highest on that hierarchy was Mervyn's. If your parents could get you something from Mervyn's, I don't know if you two are old enough to remember, like that was, you had arrived.
Yep. That was my first credit card I ever had, was a Mervyn's card in college.
See, so. There you go. But there's the whole hierarchy, you know, Burlington and all those Ross and mm-hmm. Oh, what's the other one with all the, they have everything in that store, PK or TK Maxx or something, TJ Maxx.
Oh, TJ Maxx, yeah.
TJ Maxx. I got to keep going to those stores. I can't lose my roots.
No, and so, yeah, and I went to the White House rocking my dress from Marshalls. And it doesn't matter. And all of that to just say that, you know, again, it's who you are. Be always be proud of that, you know. And actually the woman was like, "I need to go to, what dress are you going to?" You know, so be proud of that always, of when you belong at those tables. And I'm excited to follow your journey, Natalia. So please keep me informed of where you're headed. And if I can be of help in any way to you or anyone that's watching, I'm here to help and serve and support in whatever way possible. We need more New Mexicans everywhere.
Yes, we do. And I'm excited to represent them, all of us.
Absolutely. You know, we talk about arrows in the quiver, and Natalia is gathering quite a load of arrows in the quiver to support her on her success journey. And I know she's going to utilize them wisely. So, you know, now all of a sudden you've got access to the state director for United States Senator Benray Luján. I mean, that's pretty cool. I it took me a long time to get Anne's cell number, but now I have it and I try not to abuse it, but I'm pretty proud she returns my call. But it took me, I'm 51 years old almost, and you got it. Look at you, you're still in college. You're all fancy.
Yes.
What other question? We got time for at least one more question here. I got to get ready to go to my Hunt Institute training today, but I want to maximize the opportunity to pick Anne's brain, and then we'll give Anne the last word with any kind of final message she may want to send about her journey and the message to maybe young leaders and more specifically young Hispana, Latina, Mestiza, Chicana women out there who really are going to be inspired and who haven't met you yet. And that's why they're not inspired yet. Cause once people meet Anne, they know she's a superstar. So Natalia, I'll let you ask one more question, then we'll close it out with Anne.
This is just a little fun question. How was it like to be Miss New Mexico?
Ooh, I thought you were going to ask about her three Springer Spaniels. Okay. Miss New Mexico.
Maybe I'll end with that. So Miss New Mexico, it was a dream come true. My mother, my grandmother, the first thing my mother ever saw on TV was Miss America with my grandmother. And the first thing I ever remember watching on TV was Miss America with my mother. So it was a family tradition. Every year we watched Miss America. I would pull out all the curtains. I would stand up on the coffee table. I would use a headband as my crown and flowers. And so, but growing up, I never you know, I mean, it's something that just seems so far away, especially growing up in such a small town. And my pageant director, there was a local pageant director by the name of Philip Ortiz who recently passed away. And, you know, I think of him often, but he said, you know, you would be really good at Miss New Mexico. And I said, I had never worn a swimsuit in my entire life. I mean, our swimming pools in New Mexico are the arroyos, the, you know, the river, the lake. And I was like, yeah, not going to do that. And he came back and he said, no, you'd like, and he told me something that changed my mind. He said, are you going to really let a little piece of cloth, you're going to let fabric stand in the way of us stopping you from potentially going to Miss America? And I thought about it and I said, okay, well, I guess we're going to have to. And it became a community. I became Miss New Mexico because of the help and support from my community in Las Vegas. I would go out running and people, it was like a movie, you know, people were honking the car, like, go, cheering me on. It became a community affair. And all of the women that I competed with at Miss New Mexico, I think sometimes you see these shows and it's very catty. It's so far from it. The women, you have to be nice, because I'll just say this, is that if you're not nice to your competitor, you know, you need somebody to help zip up your dress or help you get ready backstage. And I always, and I, it's funny when I talk about policy and working in this field, I have actually found that, you know, they room you with your competitor, you know, your roommates, you really learn about yourself. But competing for Miss New Mexico was amazing. I still to this day pinch myself. And when I went to Miss America, I remember standing on that stage. It didn't hit me until I stood on that stage the first time and I saw folks out in the audience waving the New Mexico flag. And I was like, this is real. It's happening. And the scholarships, I earned almost $20,000 in scholarship money from the Miss America program. And we've never had, Miss America has never had a Hispanic Miss America. So any young woman out there who has been thinking about pageantry or Miss America system, don't be afraid of it. I'm here to be a mentor. I'm a pageant coach. I do a lot of the interview coaching for the Miss New Mexico's that go. But it's a wonderful program of growth. I learned so much about myself, about others. I got to travel the entire state. I got to travel throughout the country promoting my platform, which was suicide prevention. So my mom actually has my crown. I gave my crown to my mom when I came home. And you have to ask for permission to take it out of the box. But being Miss New Mexico, it was not, you know, I just have so many people to thank for that, because it was a community effort to get me there. And I'm forever grateful. It's opened many doors for me. But please, Natalia, you could be our next Miss New Mexico, you know, but the scholarships that you get from it and the growth, I'm still friends. I have a friend on all 50 states, including the Virgin Islands.
Oh, you name dropper. Sheesh. Hey, So did you, have you worked with Belia at all?
Yes. Uh-huh.
You know, Belia and I have been friends for 30 years.
So she does the Miss USA program. And a couple of years ago, she asked me to go be a judge down in Las Cruces for the Miss USA pageant. And what a wonderful, I mean, when you talk about someone who's inspirational, just inspiring, empowering women, you know, I just have so much respect for her. And we've had a lot of wonderful women who have gone through the Miss New Mexico program, both America and USA, who have not gone on to become the title holder, but they're still doing a lot of amazing, amazing things in our community.
No doubt. And so I just love Belia Alvarez with Heritage Hotels and Resorts, and Curtis Roseman, who's doing some great work with our Spaceport America. And I think he is the official tourist transport company for Virgin Galactic or Spaceport America. I'm not sure on the details, but he does these great tours of Spaceport America, pre-COVID, that is. And we just love Belia and Curtis. Curtis took me in as an opportunity, gave me an opportunity when I was in a really bad way. I was couch surfing at the time and really gave me a chance. And so I'm forever grateful to him. And I love Belia very much. We work together and remain friends for literally 3 decades now. And we stay in very close touch. So had to bring that up real quick. We're at the top of the hour, ladies. I am so grateful to both of you. I will give Anne the last word, and I will just make my last word being, I'm thankful to you, Anne, and thankful that you're in my life. I'm thankful that you've dedicated your life to service, because you know your success in life is always directly proportional to the success you help others achieve. That's my saying. It's what I believe in at my core. And I know that your success has been directly proportional to the success you've helped others achieve. And reaching out to Natalia and offering your support there, and with so many people that you lead, we're just very, very grateful for you. Now, folks, before I close off and give it to Anne for the last word, I just want to say this has been a very heavy week for America and for the world in many ways. And I just want you to reach out to folks who are in isolation and tell them they're not alone. Now more than ever, we need people's encouragement. We need people's validation and affirmation. Remember, we talked a couple months ago about the difference between encouragement and affirmation. If affirm people around you, affirm them and validate them for the path that they're on, and encourage and lift them up. And let them know that there are a lot of folks on Cafecito con Colón who are my extrovert therapist, who send their love and best regards. And me, individually, I send my love and best regards. I love you, the land of enchantment, the Tierra del Encanto, the 47th star on the beautiful flag of the United States of America, our home of the free and the brave. And one of the most brave is Anne Romero, for not letting that little piece of cloth get in the way of her excellence. We lift you up, Anne. How about a final word?
Well, thank you again, Brian. It was just this lifted me up to be on here today with you and with Natalia and with everyone who's joined us this morning. And I just want to say thank you, New Mexico. Is that if any of you, I think now during the pandemic, a lot of people are going through struggles. Whether some folks have lost their jobs, folks are having to stay at home with family, trying to figure out schooling. I just want everyone to know, I think, again, there's just such the struggle, especially with the new year, of setting a new year's resolution of things have to be a certain way. And sometimes it's just okay to be, sometimes just getting through the day is a victory and a win in itself. And it's something I've had to remind myself. I like to make lists and check things off and have these goals. And I've had to be very kind with myself and patient with one another. And so I challenge everyone that when you do go out, whether it's to the store, you're in your car, giving someone a thumbs up or a wave, whenever you find yourself feeling frustrated, thinking through how can I turn this into a positive way? And if you're feeling, stuck right now and you're going through some struggles, look for resources to help keep moving forward. And if you have something in your heart, this is, I'll just end with this, is that, I think we're off. But if you have something in your heart that you've really been wanting to do, whether it was a new career change, whether it was moving, whether it's a goal starting your business, do it. We only get one life. And what I always tell myself is, do you want to be 80 years old sitting in that rocking chair, looking back and regretting, do the things, stay positive, stay healthy, be kind and good to each other. And thank you, New Mexico, for being the greatest state. I'm just so proud to be from New Mexico. Thank you, Brian. And everyone have a wonderful, beautiful, beautiful day. And if I can help in any way, please let me know.
Perfect. Have a beautiful weekend. See you tomorrow on Cafecito con Colón. Thank you, Anne. Thank you, Natalia Garcia. You're both amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian.
You got it. Like Johnny Canales. Take it away. See you soon.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
I love you, New Mexico. Have a great day. God bless.